In a season where Michael Schumacher and Ferrari have rewritten the Formula One record books and the sport is perceived as being sanitized and safe, we remember an era when F1 was the most dangerous sport in the world and a driver who holds motor racing's most tragic record. The Italian Grand Prix at Monza marks the 32nd anniversary of the death of Jochen Rindt, Formula One's only posthumous world champion. Born in Germany in 1942 to an Austrian mother and German father, both Rindt's parents died during Allied bombing the following year, and Rindt was brought up as an Austrian by his grandparents. After leaving school, he took his place in the family's spice importing business, but was soon seduced by motorsport. Hard-nosed, aggressive, but blessed with outstanding ability, by 1965, he'd accepted a Formula One drive with the Cooper team. But the uncompetitive cars meant it was outside of F1 that Rindt's reputation was forged. That same year, he gave Ferrari their last ever victory at the Le Mans 24 Hours, driving a privately entered 250 LM with American Maston Gregory. And at a time when Grand Prix drivers routinely supplemented their income by competing in other categories, Rindt came to dominate the competitive world of F2, defeating Formula One regulars such as Jackie Ickx, Jim Clark, Graham Hill, and Jack Brabham. But success in motor racing's premier category continued to elude him, until he was signed by Colin Chapman to drive for Lotus in the 1969 season. At the tail end of the 1960s, Formula One had arguably never been so dangerous. Advances in aerodynamics, engine and tyre technology weren't matched with similar improvements in car and track safety. Frequently, the only thing separating drivers from spectators and trees was a well-positioned straw bale. Cars would routinely fly off the road when their wings broke. Drivers would be burnt alive when fuel tanks exploded. Trackside medical support was minimal. With their lives hanging by a thread, the drivers' respect for one another was absolute.
16 drivers or 18 drivers in those days. And one was dying every month. I mean, it was almost like family. It was just crazy. They were all close friends. And, you know, that went on and on. I mean, it was bad times.
It was against this background that Rindt entered the 1970 championship as one of the title favorites. While Chapman developed the revolutionary Lotus 72, Rindt started the year in the venerable Lotus 49. And it was at the wheel of the older car that Rindt took his greatest win, harrying former teammate and triple world champion Jack Brabham into a mistake on the last lap of the Monaco Grand Prix. When the Lotus 72 was finally introduced, its superiority was soon apparent. At the Dutch Grand Prix, Rindt simply disappeared into the distance. But his victory was marred by the death of close friend Piers Courage, the first fatality of the season. Even in a discipline where death was just an occupational hazard, Courage's death shocked the Formula One fraternity.
We all saw the accident, the car burst into flames. Piers's helmet was, when I came round on the first lap, rolling around the track. The race wasn't stopped. We had to go on. And when it finished, Jochen won the race and I was second.
Rindt was informed of the death of one of his closest friends on the podium. Courage's death affected him deeply, and many observers became convinced that he would retire at the end of the season. Despite the tragedy, Rindt drove with grim determination and dominated the summer races. In France, he trounced the field at Clermont-Ferrand for his third victory of the season. At the British Grand Prix, he picked up another win. And yet again, it was at the luckless Jack Brabham's expense. This time, when the Australian ran out of fuel within sight of the checkered flag at Brands Hatch. And in Germany, he got the better of Jackie Ickx's Ferrari at Hockenheim in an epic duel to complete his fourth win in a row, his fifth of the season. His only setback, failure to win his home Grand Prix in Austria. Rindt travelled to Monza in a position to clinch the drivers' championship. But rumours of his desire to leave the sport had grown ever stronger. Teammate Emerson Fittipaldi, only competing in his fourth Grand Prix, spoke to him before qualifying.
In the morning, I had breakfast with Jochen Rindt, and Jochen asked me to replace on his Formula 2 team for 1971. I told Jochen, sure, be a pleasure for me, be an honor to drive for your own team and replace you next year. I'm, sure I'll be very excited to do that. We went to the test, to the practice. I never saw Jochen again.
Half an hour into the session, Rindt's Lotus veered sharp left at the Parabolica and struck the barriers. Rindt could not survive the chest injuries and was pronounced dead on arrival at Milan's hospital. Team Lotus withdrew from the race as a mark of respect. Jochen's death on the eve of what seemed a certain world championship shocked the world of motor racing. Belgium's Jackie Ickx had a mathematical chance of passing Rindt's total, and there was discussion as to whether Rindt should be awarded the title even if his total was surpassed. The debate became academic when, fittingly, Fittipaldi took his maiden victory at the US Grand Prix, and Rindt's title was secure. For all concerned, it was the best outcome possible to a tragic season.
That year, I was very happy that the championship was won the way it should have been won, correctly on the track, and that Rindt won it. I'd never have wanted to win a championship by taking it from one of my colleagues who'd perished during the course of the season.
It was left to Jackie Stewart to present Jochen's widow Nina with the Drivers' Championship trophy. Of the drivers who competed in the 1970 championship, 11 would eventually perish at the wheel of a racing car. But while Rindt's death at just 28 robbed motor racing of one of its greatest talents, his career sparked an Austrian interest in F1 that continues to this day through Niki Lauda and Gerhard Berger. Jochen Rindt was Austria's first Formula One world champion and hopefully motor racing's last posthumous one.